Now that you've had a chance to think about Ballad of Birmingham in relation to cultural discourse, let's talk about some of those cultural discourses and how you may find out more information about them. We're going to continue to think about the relationship between literature and culture, and this is just a first exercise to help us establish a framework for that kind of analysis. So first of all, thinking about literature in its cultural context can be a little bit like detective work, especially when you have a text like this that's related to a specific historical event. When you have a scholarly edition of a text that has notes, that can really help you to identify the occasion that a poem was written about, like in this case on the church bombing in Alabama in 1963. Now the poem itself gives us that hint using that parenthetical clue that's right after the title. And if you're using the digital version of our textbook, you can click on that and see more information. And if you're using the paper version of our book, you can look down in the footnote and see more information, where it tells you that in 1963, a bomb exploded in Birmingham at the 16th Street Baptist Church, killing four girls aged 11 to 14 and injuring at least 21 other members of the predominantly African-American congregation. So that's really helpful information that helps us to understand the basic occasion for the poem. The date of the poem, 1969, also helps us to understand the cultural moment. This poem was written still in the midst of the civil rights movement in America in the mid 20th century. So given the event that inspired the poem as well as the time in which it's being written, that should give us a good sense of the discourse community and some potential dominant or subversive or competing discourses that we would want to identify. In this case, the discourse community would be any American who is interested in the events of the civil rights movement from either perspective, probably. And we can detect a sort of didactic purpose in this poem. Didactic is a term that means to educate. So in this poem, by showing the perspective of an innocent child whose parent is sending her to the church to keep her safe, and then that child being killed, there's clearly a lesson to be learned there. There's sort of a bitter irony on the part of a parent, but it's also displaying the truly horrific consequences of this terrorist act of bombing the church, showing the human cost of African Americans striving for civil rights in this era. In a sense, if we're talking about the localized discourse within the poem itself and between the two characters, the mother and the child who are talking, there is a competing discourse in terms of what does a protest march mean? To the child, the protest march means fighting for freedom. When she says, I won't be alone, other children will go with me and march the streets of Birmingham to make our country free. So she's seeing that as a form of communication, a way to advance the goals of the civil rights movement, to speak out for freedom. But the mother sees a very different view. No, baby, no, you may not go, for the dogs are fierce and wild, and clubs and horses, guns and jails aren't good for a little child. She sees the very pragmatic realities of what going to a march entails. So in a certain way, these two characters, the mother and the daughter, are competing in their discourse about how this event of the protest march is framed. For the daughter, there's a more abstract framing in terms of the ideals that are trying to be achieved. And for the mother, there's a more pragmatic framing in terms of the realities of what that march is like. So we could talk about that again in a very localized way in the discourse community of the two characters in the text having the conversation. We could talk about this as a competing discourse. And in a sense, they are representing the broader views of different people in the community, the broader community of people participating in the civil rights movement and those looking at the movement happening. They could be seen as representing different competing ideas of what those protests are like as well. And in a certain sense, that's what this poem is doing, is taking this very personal and individualized experience and using it to be representative of a larger discourse about the civil rights movement and the violence that was part of that struggle. There's another dominant discourse that's invoked here, and that's the notion of going to a church being safe. The mother takes that as an assumption that the church is going to be a much safer place for her child to go than to be out marching in the streets. And of course, part of the irony in the poem is that exactly the opposite is true. The church is the dangerous place. It's the church that's bombed and the church where the child dies. And we can think of that as a subversive message that challenges the notion that there is any safe space in this particular situation for this particular group of people. That's a pretty stark message that's being offered by the poem, and we can see that as a subversive message challenging the idea that there are some places that are safe, like a church. So that just gives you some examples of how we could apply the notion of discourse and cultural discourse to the representations in Ballad of Birmingham, how it uses personal experiences to project competing discourses about what the protest marches meant, and how it uses underlying dominant cultural discourses about, say, safety, and also subversive discourses about the universally destabilizing influence of this movement and the violence that was part of this from those challenging the protesters, to illustrate the cultural discourse in this time period and in this time frame of the mid-20th century civil rights movement in America.